It's been about 20 years since the last time I was at CMU, and it's been longer than that since I was in Wheaton Hall where I had freshman calculus. I was walking around campus today, and I was walking through Baker Hall of the slanting floors, and I thought, well, I'm back. So tonight I'm going to be talking about how to read Tolkien, and you might be wondering why such a topic needs a how-to, since well over 100 million people have read Tolkien over the past 50 years, and they seem to be doing quite all right without me or the advice of any professor, or at least any professor that's not named Tolkien. But if Tolkien is easy to read, and he must be, you know, because his work is pop culture, not literature, we have to ask why so many critics misread him, and so hilariously. My favorite being the anonymous, and lucky for him, critic from the Times Literary Supplement who wrote, "This is not a work that many adults will read right through more than once." Which, first of all, weird. What kind of criterion is that? And second of all, like, wow, talk about epic fail in prediction, because he's writing about The Lord of the Rings, which is probably the one 20th century book that people do read over and over again. Well, I'm also Goodnight Moon, but they're kind of different. Also, there's a number of important and powerful critics, including that Mr. Anonymous, but also Patricia Meyer Spax, Solomon Rushdie, Catherine Stimson, and Edmund Bunny Wilson, who, even if they are dead, apparently desperately need a how-to on reading Tolkien because they are doing it wrong. And one of the wrong things they do, and many other people do as well, is to stampede right to the question, why is Tolkien so popular? Because the answers to that question usually take a sharp turn at shallow politics and then make a beeline right for pop sociology. And since I find both of those places less congenial than Mordor, I won't be trying to do that. And therefore, I won't be telling you directly why Tolkien is so popular. Instead, I'm going to explain in part why Tolkien's work has the particular effects on readers that it does. And then you can decide if that has anything to do with its popularity. But before I go further, I want to tell a story. It's about Professor Peggy Knapp, who is in part responsible for my becoming a medievalist. Now, in order to tell the story, I have to set things up a little, because the story relies on the audience having a bit of information about the strange cultural practices of the distant past, specifically the process of course registration at Carnegie Mellon in the 1980s. And yes, there is nothing more exciting than that. Here's how it was. Way back then, things that are now done seamlessly online were done physically, in person, with pencil and paper, even at CMU. I know, I'm not making this up. To make sure you actually got the classes you wanted, you camped out overnight in the academic buildings. And in order to be first in the registration line, you slept there. Really, really, with sleeping bags and with sports bottles filled with vodka mixed with Tang. Or I heard some people did that. So after you'd signed up for your openings then, you had to meet with your advisor and get your classes approved. And this is the key point. Your advisor signed your course sheet and handed it in. You didn't get the course sheet back. This is important. You'll see why in a minute. I think it's safe to say that the specifics of the registration process at Carnegie Mellon in 1989 are not known by the current students, and they're probably hardly remembered among the faculty. And be honest, they don't keep me up all night reminiscing either. But in another 50 to 60 years, when all the people my age are dead, the knowledge will be entirely lost. Trivial social procedures often don't get recorded. Right? We have no idea how the Vikings organized lining up for battle or for getting into their ships. Though it's kind of fun to imagine, like, Ragnar is cutting me! And the point is this, if you don't know the registration process, then my story loses something. But so now that you have the cultural background, here's the story. It was the end of the first semester of my senior year. And I saw from the schedule, which is printed on paper, by the way, that Professor Knapp was going to be teaching a Chaucer class that met at 8:30 a.m. Now, I hadn't had an 8:30 a.m. class since freshman calculus, and I didn't go to that very much. So, thinking that as a second semester senior, I was going to need my sleep, I didn't sign up for Chaucer. I didn't put it on my registration form. I just took what I needed to graduate, though I did camp out in Baker Hall so I could get into Sharon Dilworth's writing workshop. And if I remember correctly, Professor Margot Livesey, who's now a famous novelist, had to step over my sleeping bag to get into her office that morning. Later, I brought my form to Professor Knapp, and this looks reasonable, she said, and it fulfills all your requirements for graduation, but you missed my Chaucer class. There was a pause. I don't see a time conflict. I said, there's no conflict, but you know, it's my second semester senior year. And there was a long pause. And then Professor Knapp said, you know, Chaucer would be a good class for you. No, I'm sure it would be, but you know, it's an 8:30 a.m. class, and you know, I'm a second semester senior. There was another long pause. I'll just add it to your form. This time there was a long pause by me. Don't worry, you'll pick up the Middle English. But I stopped because I might have been lazy, but I wasn't stupid. And that was how I ended up with an 8:30 a.m. class the second semester senior year. And it turned out to be the best single class I ever took at Carnegie Mellon. And it prepared me so well for graduate school in medieval studies that even though I had a couple year digression into getting degrees in journalism and creative writing, when I did figure out I wanted to be a medievalist, I was still ahead of all the other students in my seminar. But there's a bigger point to this story and all this setup, and it's not just a long way to go to praise Professor Knapp, who, as the story shows, wasn't just an amazing teacher, but also a wise advisor, which is, by the way, why I dedicated this book, Tradition and Influence in Anglo-Saxon Literature, to her and to my two other great teachers, John Foley and Alan Franson. Now, the story is related to my topic tonight in trying to explain how to read Tolkien. As I learned from Professor Knapp, a good medieval sermon, like The Pardoner's Tale, needs an exemplum. It needs a little story that dramatizes some of the important ideas. So now, I want you to imagine someone reading the story I just told 500 or 1,000 years from now and trying to figure it out. And by the story, I mean the way I told the story back in 1989 over in the dining room at Phi Kappa Theta, where I was surely mocked for being a wimp and giving in to my advisor. But if you left out all that setup about the registration process. So centuries in the future, it should be easy to figure out the basic information, right? The advisor who knows better pressures the lazy student into doing the right thing. And only well after the fact does the student realize how right the advisor was. You get the theme. It's the triumph of wisdom, right? But there's also a character-driven level of the story where the humor arises from the soft-spoken and kindly advisor being an unflinching badass and forcing the more expressive or opinionated or from New Jersey student to bend to her will without actually saying anything. So the point being that future readers will get something from the local context, but they won't get the social, technological, and procedural writing of the story. Where Professor Knapp's power came from, how both parties knew exactly what that power was, and how the hearers of the story over at 1069 Moorwood Avenue knew the minute that I said, I'll just add it to your form, that fate was fully determined. Those future readers might get a sense of how the whole thing worked. They might have some general idea that there was a joke that they were missing, but they wouldn't know all that context. And in summary, there's a difference between what the characters in the story know and what the reader of the story knows. And at this point, I'm guessing every single English major here is thinking, yes, Drought, this is a little thing called irony. Maybe you've heard of it. But oh, straw student into whose mouth I just put those words. You've got it backwards. Because normal irony, as I learned from Professor Knapp, comes when the reader of the story knows more than the characters. So when our protagonists go out and they book their honeymoon cruise on this beautiful new cruise ship, we shake our heads. We readers know something that the characters don't. And there's always the omnipresent irony that the readers know that we're reading a book with a certain title and a certain number of pages left till the end, while the characters, they usually don't have that information. Let's be really technical for a moment and say that in every story, in every human interaction, there's an epistemic regime, a particular distribution of knowledge. In my little story, if it's read 1,000 years in the future, the normal epistemic regime is inverted. The characters know stuff, the reader doesn't. And finally, how many minutes into this lecture I get to the Lord of the Rings? In J.R.R. Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings, the epistemic regime is the same as the one I've created for my little story. The characters know a fair bit more than the readers do because they live in Middle Earth while we live in Pittsburgh. And this epistemic regime means that things that are unknown to the reader are going to be obvious to the characters. We have no idea where the Blue Mountains are or who Elrond is, but the characters know these things and they take them for granted, and so they will refer to them utterly casually. And that dynamic will naturalize many of the things about Middle-earth that are otherwise distant and different from our world. No one boggles at the existence of a glowing sword or a magic ring. So far, so good. It's a standard technique of fantasy and science fiction. It goes back a ways before Tolkien. But wait, there's more. Not all the characters know everything about their own world. Most importantly, the hobbits, who've spent their whole lives in the insular bucolic shire, don't know much at all. Frodo has chatted with some travelers, he's looked at some maps, but he's never been anywhere. And he's the most cosmopolitan hobbit in the whole shire. The others are pretty much butt ignorant of the outside world's geography, history, and culture. But the story is focalized through the hobbits. For pretty much the entire Fellowship of the Ring, most of the Two Towers, and all of the Return of the King, Tolkien sticks to the point of view of the various hobbits. There's only one major exception, and that's at the beginning of the Two Towers, when Aragorn, Legolas, and Gimli are chasing the orcs who have captured Merry and Pippin. And they're also worrying about what's happened to Frodo and Sam. They've seen footprints, they've seen a missing boat, but they're not 100% sure. A hobbit point of view at that point would ruin the suspense. So instead, we get Gimli's point of view. Gimli! And that leads us to a very useful generalization about point of view in The Lord of the Rings, which I think we can call the least knowledgeable character hypothesis. In any given scene, Tolkien uses the point of view of the least knowledgeable character in that scene. How accurate is the LKC generalization? Well, it's pretty accurate. In the few places where Tolkien tells the story through an omniscient narrator, or he gives the point of view of seemingly knowledgeable characters like Aragorn at the very beginning of the Two Towers, or Gandalf at the beginning of Book Two of the Fellowship of the Ring, it turns out that the least knowledgeable character is generally unconscious, occasionally asleep, sometimes absent. And when the point of view is of that of a generally knowledgeable character in the particular scenes, even that character doesn't know something that's focal. Gandalf doesn't know how Frodo's going to come out from under the Morgul knife spell, if he's going to be partially invisible like a glass filled with clear light. Aragorn doesn't know where the rest of the company is. Now, let's see how that least knowledgeable character point of view interacts with the epistemic regime. The characters know more than the readers do, but inside the story, the other characters know more than the point of view character. What happens then is that the point of view characters have multiple occasions to learn things about the world in which they're in. And as they learn, the reader will learn the same information at the same time. So when Frodo says of Saruman, "Who is he? I have never heard of him before." And Gandalf answers, somewhat elliptically, the character Frodo and the reader both simultaneously learn about Saruman. They learn about him in the same way. They have to piece together Gandalf's rather opaque statements that Saruman is one of the wise, with a capital W, and that he's part of Gandalf's order, with a capital O, and that he has a PhD in ring lore and so forth. But you notice, even in that particular scene, Tolkien neatly avoids the dreaded chapter 2, the Treatise of Tedium, which is so common in fantasy literature. If you've ever read fantasy or tried to write fantasy, you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? Chapter 1 has an exciting battle and a black-cloaked demon shows up and so forth. And then in chapter 2 you get, "Now I will give you a summary of the physics, geology, geography, mythology, religion, history, social structure, technology, and customs of my imagined world." George R.R. Martin, I am looking at you. It's, by the way, very hard to avoid writing a chapter, a treatise of tedium, because you need to get this information out to your readers, right? If your Dark Lord's major weakness is going to be the crimson gauntlets of Fenway Park, then you need to work that information into the story somehow. There's some of this in the Shadow of the Past, but that chapter is 83% less boring than most chapter 2 treatises, I'm sure, because Tolkien imparts the information through the conversation with Gandalf, who lectures surprisingly little. Frodo has to drag the information out of him. And that information is incomplete. It's fragmentary. Gandalf sometimes says he doesn't know. Other times he refuses to tell things that he knows, which are actually relevant. And the reader and the character experience the same thing at the same time. Learning, which is a fundamentally different reading experience than the other emotions or sensations that can be invoked by literature. That's a pretty extreme assertion, so maybe I better argue for it. Here's the difference between learning and other reading experiences. When we read about a character feeling sadness, we can feel sad. But despite the ability of art to invoke feelings in us, the cognitive experience is not the same as that which the character has. When we read about a character being sad, we feel sadness for the character, but we're not experiencing the same sadness as the character who is sad about what's ever happening to him or her, not sad about what's being read. That's fundamentally different. And so I feel reasonably safe in saying that very few other readers are having the same experience at the same time as Frodo standing inside a volcano getting his finger bitten by Gollum. But when a character learns and you learn at the same time, you are experiencing what that character's experiencing. The same mental processes that would be taking place in the character are taking place in you. There's still mediation because there's always mediation since we're reading while the character is being told by a wizard. But the cognitive experience of learning is fundamentally alike. Now, if you interview or survey readers of The Lord of the Rings, you find some really consistent strands of discussion. The most significant of these is a high percentage of readers report that reading The Lord of the Rings is an experience, that it's qualitatively different than other books that they've read and loved. Even the critic Edmund Bunny Wilson recognized this quality in The Lord of the Rings, I think, although he attributed it to the book being long. That's all he had. And note, by the way, that The Lord of the Rings doesn't require the cognitive investment that you need to put into James Joyce's Ulysses or into Faulkner's The Sound and the Fury or into Toni Morrison's Beloved. The language is clear and straightforward. You always know where you are in time and space. And yet, the books are an experience. And they're an experience in part because the epistemic regime and the least knowledgeable character point of view contribute to the reader's learning at the same time as the characters, producing this similarity of experience. But that's not all. The next piece of the puzzle contributes to this phenomenological quality. Under an epistemic regime in which the characters know stuff that the reader doesn't, characters are going to refer to things in their own culture in, as we've noted, an entirely casual, offhand way. For instance, Aragorn says of Gandalf, he is surer of finding the way home in a blind night than the cats of Queen Beruthiel. Because none of the characters react with a, what you talking about, Strider? Or, Queen who? Instead, we are given the impression that everybody in the company knows who Queen Beruthiel is. There's this world full of history and culture that surrounds the characters. And by the way, how can it be that there is no website, The Lolcats of Queen Beruthiel? It would combine pictures of cats and Tolkien. And yet it doesn't exist. The internet has failed. Cultural knowledge that speakers assume to be widespread gets referenced all the time in conversational, journalistic, literary discourse, and we just don't notice it because most of the time it works so well. The reference just gives us information. And by the way, people don't use references just to seem clever either, though that's undoubtedly part of the pleasure. References are useful. They communicate more information than they themselves contain. This may seem to violate principles of Shannon Weaver information theory, but it doesn't. Because what's happening when a reference works is that a whole lot of information that's previously passed into the mind is being invoked by a very small reference. Let's say I make a mistake and go, "Doe!" All I did was utter a monosyllable. But if you're part of the same culture, then that monosyllable invoked information that you had already received and put into your minds. This principle in oral traditional studies is called communicative economy. The use of references is just part of regular discourse. We don't notice them very much, but when they don't work, they stand out. And that's where the cats of Queen Beruthiel comes in. For the characters, it's just an ordinary reference. For the reader, Instead of invoking of information about what the Cats of Queen Beruthiel might possibly mean, you get this. You get a 404. The reference does exactly the opposite of what a regular reference does. Instead of communicating information efficiently, it highlights the failure of communication. Let's call those 404s broken references. And note that the extreme communicative economy for the participants in the culture means that there's no redundancy in the information, and therefore almost no information at all once the continuity of culture is broken. A broken reference emphasizes that the reader is not part of the same cultural world as the characters. And it emphasizes that that cultural world is rich and complex enough to have a whole pile of references which are now broken. Now, we're not done with broken references, but let's tie them in with the epistemic regime and the least knowledgeable character point of view. The characters know stuff that the reader doesn't. Apparently, who those damn cats are. The broken reference can arise directly from that epistemic regime. However, that could work at cross purposes with the LKC, with the least knowledgeable character. A broken reference can distance the reader from the characters, but Tolkien had a clever solution to this problem. For example, at the eponymous Council of Elrond, Elrond says that by accepting the quest of the ring, Frodo has earned himself a seat among the great elf friends, including Hador and Húrin and Beren himself. Now, Elrond may be annoying sometimes, and actually, he might be more annoying than the real Elrond, but he's not deliberately confusing here, since that would completely undercut his rhetorical purpose. He's instead speaking in an idiom that he expects to be understood by his interlocutors. He may be wrong, because he's 6,000 years old, and you know, young hobbits these days with their attention spans and everything, but he's trying to communicate. I mean, although as Hugo Weaving plays the character, Elrond has managed to get through 6,000 years without ever learning that just yelling at people and raising your eyebrow doesn't actually convince anyone, but I digress. Now, there are those first three names in the list of elf friends are at this point in the narrative entirely unknown to the reader of The Lord of the Rings. And therefore, their connotations are unavailable. Even any denotations beyond some general idea, positive notion of an elf friend can only be interpreted in the local context. Because the character making the reference apparently also understands the backgrounds of the stories of Hador and Húrin and Túrin, and assumes that the readers do also, readers have to infer the existence of a rich cultural context outside that of the story. The overall effect, then, of the combination of the epistemic regime, the LKC point of view, and the appearance of broken references is to make the cognitive experience of the reader very much like that of the focal characters. Participants in the culture, but not the most knowledgeable, who are learning about their own world's history and culture in an organic way. The way that we as children learn about our world, overhearing conversation, making connections, putting things together from messy data, rather than being given it all in a treatise of tedium or a long lecture on the history of the world. Now, this overall effect may go a bit further towards an explanation of why Tolkien's works seem qualitatively different, both from mainstream literature of the 20th century and the rest of the fantasy genre. Again, it's a cognitive experience analogous to being a child learning about its culture and its world, which also may explain another aspect of the phenomenology of The Lord of the Rings, that so many people link it to experiences of growth or initiation. As Gandalf notes, the hobbits have grown during the course of the story, and likewise readers feel as if they have an experience of development. I think it's the experience of learning, which is certainly much intertwined with childhood and growth and development. And now we go back and pick up the thread of broken references. Because although they contribute to the experiential of The Lord of the Rings, that's not all they do. If you are a true Tolkien geek, then you already know that there is a fundamental difference between the Cats of Queen Beruthiel and Elrond's list of elf friends. But just in case you're not a complete Tolkien geek, I will tell you. And the difference is that in 1954, when The Lord of the Rings was published, there was no reference anywhere in Tolkien's writings, published or unpublished, to the Cats of Queen Beruthiel, while all of Elrond's elf friends, that sounds like a name for a band, like a really nerdy band, like they might be giants, like Elrond's elf friends, but all of Elrond's super elf friends were in the unpublished Silmarillion material. Tolkien had already written their stories. Now, from the point of view of the reader, this makes absolutely no difference at all. A broken reference is a broken reference. But for Tolkien himself, there's a distinction. What we can mark by calling Queen Beruthiel's cats, which would be a good name for a jazz quartet, by the way, a pseudo-reference. And Elrond's super elf friends is a broken reference. Now, surprisingly, almost all the references in The Lord of the Rings are broken rather than pseudo. Tolkien himself said it was just the cats of Queen Beruthiel and the otherwise unexplained two extra wizards that Saruman mentions on Orthanc. Everything else, according to Tolkien, as best I can tell, shows up in the Silmarillion material or in the appendices. Now, Tolkien is not the first fantasy or science fiction writer to create pseudo-references, by the way. Jules Verne's cryptic manuscript by Arne Saknussemm in The Journey to the Center of the Earth, H.P. Lovecraft's Necronomicon, Robert Chambers's The King in Yellow, all of those are pseudo-references. And these guys are hardly the first to invent them. Malory's French book, from which he claims he gets a lot of his Arthurian material, or Geoffrey of Monmouth's, my favorite, Liber Vitosissimus, the oldest book, where he claims he gets stuff that he's actually just making up. All of these are pseudo-references also. And maybe even Chaucer's Book of the Lion, which possibly, or maybe even probably, never existed. The pseudo-reference is a way of authenticating the author's inventions, making them seem like they're part of a long tradition, which is a point we'll come back to. But in Tolkien's case, although the fake references weren't actually fake, the reader can't know that they are. But the existence of the references still has an effect, because those pseudo-references all point to actual stories. They have, to use one of my favorite German words, a Zusammenhang, a hanging together, a subtle consistency. How do you know that there used to be more arches here? Well, when you've seen as many arches as I have, you can fill in the pattern, right? Tolkien's references fit some sort of subtle out-of-view pattern, and they hang together in a way that H.P. Lovecraft's or Stephen R. Donaldson or Terry Brooks' references don't. Readers can tell. A similar coherence of background gives Beowulf much of its particular quality of feeling historically true, or as Tolkien put it, taking place in the named lands of the North, even if it includes trolls, sea monsters, and a dragon. But what makes Beowulf similar to The Lord of the Rings, or more properly, vice versa, is that none, and I mean absolutely none, of the references in Beowulf contradict with each other or with the few times that they appear in historical sources. The Beowulfian material, get this, doesn't even contradict itself when it shows up in later texts that do contradict each other. Let me explain what I mean by that. If we go through Beowulf and we reconstruct whatever we can from the hints and the allusions, we find that none of those stories are directly opposed to what shows up in the later sources, even though sometimes those give a fuller picture. Now, those stories are often much elaborated, and what it looks like is that tradition moved off in a variety of different directions. It spread out from the source at the same time the source that was the Beowulf poet's source, so that you eventually do get conflicting versions of the Sigurd and Sigmund story. But the Beowulf version is basically consistent with either of the later developments. In other words, the conflicts are in them, not in it between them. Now, Beowulf itself is maddeningly elusive. Does Waltheow intentionally give Beowulf a cursed necklace? Or is the necklace cursed, but she doesn't know about it? Or is it not cursed at all, and just later scholars have made up this curse thing? Does Hrothulf later murder his cousins and siege the Danish throne? And if so, did the audience know this was happening? We just don't know. There's lots of stuff we just don't know, because the references are broken. But in Beowulf, you never get the sense that you do in the Nibelungenlied or in Volsunga Saga or in Gudrun, that the writer has this general idea that two events go together but doesn't really know why and so messes it up by sticking them together. This is what happens for the quarrel of the queens in the Volsung material. That conflict was, the things that don't make sense made sense to someone. They just got messed up in translation later on, but not in Beowulf. All this suggests, by the way, that the Beowulf poet was working in a living culture that he knew very well, while later writers were working from half-understood historical material and references that were broken even for them 500, 600, 1,000 years ago. The references in The Lord of the Rings and the Silmarillion material do the same thing as those in Beowulf, even though Tolkien just made that stuff up. And that's another reason why The Lord of the Rings reads differently than almost any other 20th century book, and why you have to read it in a certain way. Tolkien's work contains references that point not to the common stock of shared external cultural material that everybody knows, like T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland, but he also doesn't just make crap up at the spur of the moment whenever it's useful, the way that Lovecraft or Thomas Pynchon does. So The Lord of the Rings has the coherence of Eliot, but the estrangement of Pynchon. And the combination of these two seemingly orthogonal forces creates something new and something different. And there's an analogy which I think is useful, and which you may have guessed from the vacation snapshots I've been projecting behind me. And actually, they're not from my vacation. They're from this company called Scholarly Sojourns that I've been doing tours with of Anglo-Saxon England and Iceland and Tolkien's England. You should come. We could get together. But I'm also projecting these here to avoid having, say, a picture of Homer Simpson saying dough hanging over my head for 15 minutes. But I also wanted to semi-subliminally get you thinking about ruins, because I think that the idea and the image and the analogy of the ruin is extremely helpful for understanding Tolkien. In some ways, a ruin is coherent. It's usually just from one source, and it's usually more compact than the original building. Sometimes it's just a pillar. But a ruin is also fragmentary. It's a part estranged from its original context. A ruin is a reference that is at least as broken in information and cultural terms as it is physically. It makes concrete both loss and coherence, both damage and persistence. And blatant self-promotion here, the book I'm in the process of finishing on Tolkien is called The Tower and the Ruin. So you might guess that I think ruins are pretty important to understanding Tolkien. You would be right if you guessed that. Now, it's not just that there are a lot of ruins in The Lord of the Rings, although there are plenty, including the Tower of Amon Sul on Weathertop, the stones of Eregion, the ruined cities of Osgiliath and Minas Morgul, and various other fallen statues, abandoned high seats, moss-covered walls, collapsed castles, broken bridges, and unmaintained roads that are littering Middle Earth. Really, they need a building code more than they need a white council. But I will spare you an exhaustive tracing of all the ruins in Middle Earth. You can get that in the book if I ever finish it. But I want to show you this little graph, which shows that despite there being ruins all over the place, the only section of the book that really contains a great deal of something being actively ruined is the scouring of the Shire. The verb ruin achieves its greatest prominence here when the beloved home of the main characters has been partially destroyed, creating great pain in our protagonists, a pain to which we'll also return. Beyond the particular ruins in Middle-earth, there's also a deeper analogical relationship between what we read in the book and what Tolkien creates with it as a whole. He builds, if that's a right word, he builds a textual ruin in The Lord of the Rings. And so reading the book in those terms helps us to understand how it works and what effects it has on its readers. So, short digression. My long-suffering wife is a PhD student. She's a PhD. Was a student when I was a student. She's a PhD in engineering, although she went to some engineering school in Massachusetts, Cambridge, rather than to CMU, but she's still okay. She really is. So when I first figured out this ruin parallel, I was working through these ideas and I was saying things like, oh my gosh, you know, I wonder what you have to figure out, like how to make a ruin. I doubt there's any kind of field in like how to make ruins. I mean, this could be like a whole new interdisciplinary thing. You could study ruins and you could figure out how to make it. And Raquel kind of sighed and she went, tribology. And she also told me that even at Carnegie Mellon, no one was going to laugh at a tribology joke, and she was right, so I think I owe her something now. I said people would. Even though Carnegie Mellon, by the way, has one of the best tribology labs in the entire world, in this building, by the way, I think, or it's over, maybe it's over in Mech E, it's apparently not common knowledge that tribology is the name of the study of surfaces moving across each other, friction and wearing. It's about how things get ruined. So this is a picture of Phi Kappa Theta's 1989 Spring Carnival booth. The theme was children's toys and the beautiful house for which I, among other things, carved all the gingerbread and built the cupola, represented the board game Clue. And all the work I put in was justified when we won the booth competition that year, except, oh, we didn't win the booth competition. We came in second place. I'd almost forgotten that that had happened. I am not bitter. I am just pointing out there was a spiral staircase inside, and it passed building code. This is Sutter's Mill. It's a picture of Phi Kappa Theta's 1990 Spring Carnival booth. And even though that year I mostly only built the working water wheel and the game, and I didn't skip spring break, and I didn't stay awake for 56 consecutive hours leading up to carnival and then sleep through the entire carnival itself, and I didn't step on a nail that came out through the top of my foot, nevertheless, this booth won first place, the way Clue should have. But although I'm not bitter, even though Clue had stained glass windows on the first floor, there's a relevant lesson in the two booths, one that was taught to me by my roommate, Jim Kempf, who was a drama production major, and you may have seen some of the windows he recently designed for FAO Schwartz, another Carnegie Mellon success. Well, after the Sutter's Mill booth was built, Jim went to work. He filled up an old-fashioned metal fire extinguisher with some kind of hideous mix of stain, paint, oil, and ink, and he sprayed it all over the boards. And he had me and about 10 other people spend hours and hours sanding down all the steps in the middles so that the treads formed a shallow parabola. He walked around the booth with a hammer, banging on things, making dents on the corners and the walls. He knocked boards out and then nailed them back just slightly crooked. And in the end, Sutter's Mill looked like what we would expect Sutter's Mill to look like. And yes, I used to have hair. While Clue looked like the really awesome, beautiful, far too blue Victorian house that Peter Pizarro, now the CEO of Multiply, and I wanted to build one day. Another CMU success story. He's a multimillionaire and I'm not. It wasn't, in other words, it wasn't quite enough like the creepy old house from Clue because it wasn't worn enough. Because nevertheless, it was still better than the allegedly first place Fisher Price garage that somebody else built, which I think looked just like that, that didn't even have an inside, much less a cupola. But it turns out that there are characteristic ways that human artifacts wear over time, so it's not surprising that the study of the phenomenon has a name, that aforementioned tribology, which I guess if nobody learns anything else tonight, you learned about tribology. But it may be surprising how good our eyes are at recognizing these signs, and thus requiring very clever drama production majors to develop a whole set of methods for artificially wearing props so that they don't dispel the illusions by being too new, too perfect. We recognize the patina of age. Right here on campus we have Hammerschlag in his nose. And then there's the fence, which has a look and a feel you can only get by applying hundreds and hundreds of coats of paint of different qualities and colors and different climate conditions with different intervals between them. And then there are ruins like those of Whitby Abbey or the monastery at Lindisfarne. And these show not only the weathering of time, but the damage caused by human violence, and then again by the elements. We recognize the marks of deep time on objects, and often we like it. Supposedly, when Yale University built their Gothic Revival buildings, they had acid poured on the newly carved stone to make it soft and weathered and look like that at Oxford. And then they regretted this 100 years later when they had to rebuild it all. The artist Joseph Cornell, whose aesthetic sense is surprisingly often like Tolkien's, artificially weathered some of his famous boxes. You can see where this is going. The analogy I want to make is between Tolkien's texts and the ruin in the landscape, made precious in part because the patinas and the wear patterns are so difficult to counterfeit. But how do you make a textual ruin? Well, this is one way. This is a picture of Tolkien's original intentions for the key leaves of the Book of Mazerbal, the damaged volume found in the chamber with Balin's tomb. Instead of having the scene written the way it is, with Gandalf puzzling through the text and reading it out loud, Tolkien wanted to publish a facsimile of these leaves, which he created and then distressed. That turned out to be too expensive. By the way, I think the Book of Mazerbal is actually inspired by the Ragan Rudis Codex, which supposedly St. Boniface uses to ward off the attacks of the heathen, and you can see the slice marks in the top and bottom, and so it might even be true. It's also a little bit like the Beowulf manuscript, which was part of Sir Robert Cotton's library and so was housed in the unfortunately named Ashburnham House. Yes, and it caught fire in 1731. And you can see that the manuscript was singed, though fortunately not destroyed. Other manuscripts were less lucky. We've lost maybe 1,500 letters out of Beowulf, many of which we can puzzle out with various techniques, but some sections of the manuscript, including the key transitional section, are sadly very hard to read. So one thing Tolkien could have done was to write his book and then physically damage it, set it on fire, rip the pages, chop it with a battle axe, and then pour some blood on it. That might be troublesome for a publisher, and it would also make The Lord of the Rings kind of fundamentally alien to the culture in which Tolkien wanted to be received. But here's another way. When most people encounter Beowulf, it's in a book like any other. Not only lacking fire damage, but lacking gaps and in problems where we don't have our full understanding of the work. The final smooth modern English translation by Seamus Heaney, however, is not how a philologist like Tolkien or me or Professor Knapp engages with his work. Philologists work at a place in the continuum between damaged manuscript and paperback translation. Now, Tolkien had created the most important edition ever of Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, and he understood how editions of texts like Kleber's Beowulf have to handle the gaps and inconsistencies of the manuscript record, sometimes using the remarkable powers of scientific philology to reconstruct a missing word or make sense of an opaque passage, but other times requiring pure speculation, and even then relegating it to the apparatus criticus, the footnotes of the discussion at the back of the book. The gaps and inconsistencies are in many ways the most interesting part of the text, and yet they're left out of the modern English translations that we read as students. Thus, some of that patina of age is polished away. Beowulf becomes a monster-fighting superhero without any of the poem's cultural depth. Tolkien could see in Beowulf, in Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, Sir Orfeo, and the Reeve's Tale, the marks of the wearing of the text as it tumbled down the stream of culture. Philologists are the tribologists of texts. I'm going to get that word into your head. Philologists are the tribologists of texts. Minds lucky enough to be trained by great teachers, like Professor Knapp, know how to detect the inconsistencies, the gaps, the broken references. And all of these features give old texts a certain feel, a sense that though they're incomplete, now they once were coherent. Broken references are markers of age. They're features of the textual patina that, in the case of Beowulf or the Volsung Saga, developed over vast cultural time. Or, in Tolkien's writing process, over the many drafts and reticulated textual histories of the Silmarillion material and the Lord of the Rings. A broken reference has become separated from its background information. But if the reference nevertheless continues to be replicated, it can evolve into what scholars of oral tradition have called a traditional referent. Just like a traditional referent metonymically invokes previously accumulated information through communicative economy. But unlike a reference, which is linked to cultural information that is outside the text, pace Derrida, but he's wrong anyway on that count, a traditional referent becomes linked only to information inside the discourse. For example, in certain Icelandic sagas in which he appears, Bjarni Brod Helgason is a peaceful man. In Vapinfirthinga saga, we're going to be going there if you go on my Iceland trip, he's reluctant to take revenge. He's eager to reconcile in Vothu Brandsdatter, and he's clever and honorable in Thorstein's Thatter Stannarhogs. So his nickname, Viga Bjarni, Killer Barney, is somewhat at odds with his character, especially in the sagas that come from the east part of Iceland, where Bjarni was from. The distinction between name and personality seems to be the point, especially in Thorstein's Staffstruck. But the denotative meaning of Viga Bjarni's name appears to have overpowered his character in the later sagas from the west part of Iceland, where people had not known Bjarni Brod Helgason, or they didn't know the transmitted knowledge about his personality. In those texts, Killer Barney is now a blood-loving, death-dealing maniac. I hate you, you hate me, I had to slaughter members of my family. Sorry. The Killer Barney effect shows how references get separated from external material to which they originally pointed, and then take on a new set of meanings based on their surface forms in their local context. A broken reference becomes a full traditional referent when it begins to be replicated in its own form. References that have evolved then into mnemonically stable forms are more likely to become traditional reference. And mnemonically stable forms are exactly those of a culture's poetry, marked by certain formal features like alliteration, meter, and rhyme. I tried to come up with it with a traditional referent to drop into my little registration story, and the best I could come was like registration legislation, which actually made me throw up in my mouth a little bit, so I decided not to use that. But by definition, mnemonically stable forms change less or more slowly than their matrices. Therefore, they're more likely to preserve archaisms and older forms, and thus linguistically marking traditional reference, which are already, because they're broken, marked semantically, marked at the level of content. And some of the references in The Lord of the Rings have the characteristics of traditional reference. Elrond's comparison of Frodo to those heroes in the First Age is marked by patterns of formal features. Elf friends of old, Hador, and Húrin, and Túrin, and Beren himself were assembled. The passage is organized paratactically, practically without subordination, and the repeated coordinating conjunctions and is an example of anaphora. And these poetic features contribute to the passage's reproduction of its own form. You can also see this in things where the palantiri are the stones of seeing. The ruler of Rivendell is Elrond half-elven. The Rohirrim are descended from Hador the golden-haired. The presence, then, of not just broken references, but what seemed to be traditional reference in The Lord of the Rings made the work not only appear to participate in a wider culture, but to be part of a tradition. And other features of the book indicates it's a tradition of a specific kind, a textual tradition. Throughout The Lord of the Rings, we find hints that the cultural background that's informing the broken references is instantiated and transmitted primarily through texts. Most prominently, there's the frame narrative of The Lord of the Rings being a translation of the Red Book of Westmarch. But not just the Red Book itself, which was based originally on Bilbo's and Frodo's diaries, but a certain copy of the Red Book that was revised and updated and expanded by Fingal, the king's scribe in Gondor. You've already got at least a three-stage and probably a five-stage textual tradition right in that frame narrative, not just one frame. Ever wonder why in The Lord of the Rings people could just burst into speech in languages that they don't actually speak? Or spontaneously recite metrically flawless poetry that they are supposed to have made up on the spur of the moment? Or translate Elvish to the common speech on the fly and have it come out as well-formed verse? Yes, you're not the only ones who have wondered that. But the answer is that The Lord of the Rings gives us the impression of being part of a textual tradition. In the case of the poetry, it's like the manuscripts of the Venerable Bede's Ecclesiastical History, in which Bede gives his Latin translation of the poem Cædmon's Hymn, which was originally written in Old English. Soon afterwards, somebody else comes along and writes the actual poem down there in the margin. Later copies then interpolate this poem into an Old English translation and leave out the Latin entirely. This is one of the ways you have to read The Lord of the Rings, differently from mainstream novels of the 20th century. Rather than characters bursting into poetry being an embarrassing flaw, people say, oh my God, nobody does that. It's a powerful mimetic feature. It's just not mimetic of real life. It's mimetic of the textual traditions of the Middle Ages. And it's not just the traditional references inserted into poems that give this impression. There's also a mix of prose styles. From almost biblical high style, such as, sing and rejoice, you people of the Tower of Guard, to goofy hobbit jokes, and everything in between. This is a dendrogram that illustrates the vocabulary distributions, and you'll see how many large branches there are. That's characteristic of multiple novels by multiple people, not one person in his own novel, which usually ends up looking something like just that part of the dendrogram, a step going down. So It's very inconsistent. And those inconsistencies don't only operate at the level of the vocabulary, they operate at semantic levels and higher. For example, is Tom Bombadil the oldest living thing in Middle-earth? Or is Treebeard? Gandalf says that Treebeard is. Tom says that he is. Tolkien never resolves it. Does Glorfindel's horse have a bridle and reins or not? Says he doesn't, except Frodo pulls on it at one point. Where did it come from, we must ask. In these and other features of The Lord of the Rings, we get the hint of it being part of a textual tradition, one that has been contributed to by various minds and hands, and that has been worn by the passage of time. And that's why you have to read Tolkien in a special way, one that medievalists are used to employing, but which ordinary critics often don't get, because they didn't have Professor Knapp as their teachers. Let's take a moment to criticize one, shall we? Catherine Stimson, who was once a big-time famous critic, she mocked Tolkien for, she said, always writing, to the eyot they came, rather than they came to an island. Bummer for her that the phrase to the eyot they came never appears in The Lord of the Rings. Oops. But don't worry, that's just a trivial error, and she's actually larger wrong in her larger big point also. Because she's wrong about eyot, as many other critics who've gotten worked up by Tolkien, by saying it's archaic. He said laving his hands when he just meant washing. It's artificial. No good writer writes this way. Except that, as we just noted, the conservation of archaic forms is characteristic of traditional reference. And those words are contributing to the pervasive sense that The Lord of the Rings is part of a long textual tradition, not something just invented by one Oxford don. Oh, and by the way, also, eyot is the technically correct name for what Tolkien's talking about, a low, gravelly, semi-island that only sticks out of the water when the river water level is low. Furthermore, the etymological source of eyot is the Anglo-Saxon word eyot, and since the place where the eyots are is on the border of Rohan, where they speak Anglo-Saxon, turns out that eyot is exactly the appropriate word, fail for poor Ms. Stimson. Also, laving, which was some other critic whose name I couldn't remember, was wrong. Laving wasn't bad because at that particular moment, they are not just washing off blood or dirt, but actually having a sort of quasi-magic ritual where Strider is taking herb-scented liquid and putting it on the foreheads of people under a magic spell of the black breath. And so, in fact, laving would be the precise correct word there, used in Beowulf in the same sense and having almost a biblical sense going back. So, pro tip, modernist critics, do not meddle in the affairs of philologists. For you are crunchy and taste good with ketchup. I mean, for they are subtle and quick to anger and know more than you do. Indeed, if I had to give a one-phrase answer for the question of how should we read Tolkien, I'd answer, like a philologist. And then maybe I'd take pity and say that what you should read is as someone who studies histories of languages and text, because when you do, you see very clearly that the features of Tolkien's text that are different from mainstream modernist fiction of the 20th century aren't necessarily errors or flaws, but are factors contributing to the particular effects of The Lord of the Rings. Whoops. So the epistemic regime and the least knowledgeable character point of view combine to make us experience some of what the characters are experiencing. They're learning about the cultural world in a piecemeal way. At the same time, the broken references, the traditional reference, the archaism in vocabulary and in style, and the many variations in prose, the use of multiple frames, the references to multiple texts, all combine to distance us from the very world that we are experiencing. We are part of that world. It's vividly present in the way that Tolkien writes description, almost always from the point of view of 4.5 feet above the ground, limited mostly to line of sight, described in terms of broad impressions rather than explicit sensory detail, all of which I learned in Creative Writing Workshop was bad. And it is in creative writing, but not in Tolkien. So we're part of this world, but at the same time, we're separated from it by a vast gulf of time. We might be holding a paperback book with Barbara Remington's ridiculous illustrations on the cover. I mean, really, emus? Bulbous fruit? But when reading, we get the impression of vast cultural depth. And that simultaneous feeling of immediate presence and irreparable loss, of connection and utter separation, is also the effect of the ruin in the landscape. Because a ruin, despite all its permanence, no, because of all its permanence, is a tangible marker. It's an absolute insistence on the pastness of the past. And that absolute pastness, combined with everything else we've discussed, is the generator of the dominant emotion in Tolkien's work. And that emotion is nostalgia, the pain for the loss of one's own home. And nostalgia has a pretty bad reputation in 20th century literature, so I was tempted to use the German word, Heimweh, home pain. But they're the same, And nostalgia doesn't deserve this opprobrium anyway. Real deep nostalgia is an intense love for an unrecoverable past. A joy triggered by tiny glimpses of the past and the present. And most of all, a pervading sadness. It's Franz Hofmeister, a Dutch videographer, filmed his daughter for a couple minutes a day every week, once a week, for 12 consecutive years, and then ran it all as one film, so you can see her growing and aging as that goes on. We don't have to do any deep psychoanalysis of Tolkien and his personal history to understand why he might have felt such a longing of nostalgia. Maybe for the idyllic rural days in Warwickshire before his mother's death, or for the beautiful summer of 1914. But you don't have to have Tolkien's tragic childhood and youth to feel deep nostalgia. You don't have to have your father die and then your mother be shunned by her family for her conversion to Catholicism, and then have your mother die and leave you an orphan, and then have almost all of your friends killed in the trenches of World War I, and then get trench fever and never fully recover your health. You don't have to have that happen to you to feel the pain of a lost home. Simply being a human, incarnate in the irreversible stream of time, is enough. And for me, the sense of Heimweh is utterly acute, almost unbearable. When I watched that little film that Franz Hofmeister made by photographing his daughter once every week for 12 years, I know from clear memory that I would not want to re-experience some of those moments again with my own child, the anxiety, the illnesses, the exhaustion. But what wouldn't I give to be able to go back to some of those moments in more than memory? The pain is only made bearable, the sadness only made blessed by love and by art. One doesn't need to go down the rabbit hole of Deleuze and Guattari, especially because St. Augustine said it all first, to see that reading is a kind of doubled consciousness, existing somewhere between pure memory and lived experience. When we look at our own children, we see not only their current forms, but all they have been before. In this kind of doubled perception, love and sadness are intertwined. The ruin in the landscape, or the textual ruin created by all of Tolkien's techniques, catalyzes this change, linking together the imagination, the current experience, and recollection, entwining the past and the present with each other, so they are, in Aragorn's dying words, more than memory. More than memory transmutes the pain of exile, of separation, and loss through the moment of time, the Heimweh, into something still sad, but now, as Tolkien says of the tears of the hobbits at their parting at the Grey Havens, blessed without bitterness. In the year 1110, the bodies of King Alfred, his wife Alswith, and their son Edward the Elder were translated from the New Minster to Hyde Abbey, where they were buried in front of the high altar. The abbey was so thoroughly destroyed during the dissolution of the monasteries that only the gatehouse remained. Not until the 20th century did archaeologists identify the previous location of the old high altar, and for years the spot was unmarked. A stretch of King Alfred Place between Monk's Road and Alswitha Terrace, commemorated, in the words of Simon Keynes, only by the flowers that grow in a suburban back garden. But in more recent years, a park was built with three cenotaphs to mark the old locations of the graves. And then artist Tracy Shepherd created an etched glass panel that depicts the interior of the abbey. If you stand so that the grave markers in the etching are aligned with those in the ground, you have the uncanny sense of being in two times at once. But the edifice, the accomplishment of human building, is 1,000 years past, faded in white. It is there in front of you, but it's forever beyond your reach. Just as the lost days of the past can be called to memory, but cannot be lived again, by standing in this place, you can experience the doubling, see with more than the mind's eye, and yet always the houses and the parked cars and the lampposts and the electric wires are ghosts just beyond the white walls, peeping through the mist, no matter how hard you try not to see them, the present overcoming the past. I feel this walking on Carnegie Mellon's campus today. The past is everywhere and yet at the same time out of reach, overlaid permanently by the present, worn away by time and change and even fallible memory. You don't have to wait a quarter century from the time of some of your most cherished memories to have this feeling, though such a gap certainly accentuates it. The price of a memory is the memory of the sorrow it brings, says the song. Pain for the lost home is common to every human as we are separated from our childhoods, from our youths, from our first experiences. How do you read Tolkien? By paying attention to the ways that different features of his works combine to produce and transform sadness, not into bitterness, but into something richer, greater, something fully human. Reading Tolkien this way, you see the true scope of his achievement to touch the heart. And you understand how much more fully how Sam's words, "Well, I'm back," are both joyous and heartbreaking. Thank you.